Hello, I'm Steve Jackson. I'm an academic researcher at the University of Cambridge, based in a place called the Gurdon Institute. And what I'm going to be talking to you about today is some of the fundamental cell and molecular biology that's emanated from my academic lab over the years, and how, in certain instances, we find opportunities to translate this fundamental biology towards developing new medicines. So this is my research team based in the Institute. We are part of the University of Cambridge. It's an academic environment. But over the years, as I mentioned a moment ago, we've found opportunities to take this research that we produced forward through a number of companies, that three of which I'm going to discuss briefly during the course of my talk with you today. Okay. Now, before going into this, I just wanted to share with you my excitement about where we are in biology right now. I've been running an academic lab for 30 years, but never has there been more exciting times to be working in the realm of biology and its relationship to medicine. And that's because right now we have a whole range of technologies and applications and procedures that we wouldn't have even deemed to be possible just a few years ago. And of course, we have things such as next generation sequencing and associated bioinformatics, which is providing both experimental tools, but also insights into the genetics of many human diseases. So in addition to being able to read DNA, we also have opportunities now to generate DNA in accurate and massively parallel ways through DNA synthesis technologies. We also have a range of cellular and associated organoid models now available to us. Much of these, for example, stem from ES and induced pluripotent stem cells, which can be differentiated into various cell types. And of course, we also have technologies such as genome engineering by CRISPR-Cas9 and related systems. We have advanced imaging and analyses, computational predictions of chemical and drug target structures. So collectively, we're now in a position to generate and characterize biological models and also human disease models with the kind of precision and accuracy that we wouldn't have even thought possible just a few years ago. And I think these kinds of developments are not only going to help us understand more about human biology and other biologies, but are also going to accelerate opportunities for translating that towards healthcare and medicine outputs through drug discovery, for example. Now, when thinking about the aspects of DNA repair and in fact, biology in general, we all know, of course, that genetics is very, very important. The genetics of our cells, the genetics of other organism cells has huge impacts on the phenotypes, the properties of those cells and the organisms collectively, as well as impacting on disease. But we must bear in mind that gene products don't work in isolation. So a product from gene A doesn't generally work on its own. It'll work together with other gene products in pathways, in protein complexes, in cooperative ways, but also in antagonistic ways in some circumstances. So taking this on board, it's clear that a phenotype caused by a variant in a particular gene is going to be strongly affected in most instances by the activities of other genes and their encoded products, of course, also being impacted by environmental factors. So when thinking about these genetic interactions, if you want to call them that, we've learned over the last 100 years that there is a spectrum of functional interaction between genes and products. The two extremes I'm just going to share with you now. Now, of course, certain gene products and the genes that encode them don't really meaningfully functionally interact. For example, a gene encoding an olfactory receptor is not going to have a major interaction genetically or functionally with a gene that, for example, specifies hand development early in embryogenesis. But in other instances, there can be very profound interactions between genes and gene products. One end of the spectrum is of genetic enhancement is something called synthetic lethality. Now, we use the word synthetic because this is brought about by bringing together more than one thing together to generate something new. In this case, you can see in this scenario here, we have a gene A and a gene B in their normal versions or invariant versions or knocked out, for example, inactivated. And in this synthetic lethality scenario here, a cell or an organism can survive without the function of gene A or with the change in gene A, or without gene B or a change in gene B. But when you bring these two genetic changes together, this generates a very, very profound cellular or organism phenotype of death, synthetic lethality. At the other end of the extreme, we have genetic suppression, and its most extreme example is synthetic viability. And in this scenario here, a change or loss of gene A function gives rise to a very profound pathology or death, and this can be rebalanced or corrected, alleviated by a change or loss of gene B. So we've learned over the years that these kind of genetic interactions arise in just about every aspect of cellular and organism functions. And we've also learned that these provide interesting opportunities for understanding biological and disease mechanisms, as well as developing new medicines. Now, my lab over the last 25 years or so has focused on the fascinating subject of DNA repair and associated DNA damage signaling pathways, collectively referred to often as the DNA damage response. So it turns out that every cell in your body is being subjected to a range of chemical and other factors which can damage DNA. DNA is a relatively inert chemical. We have lots of it inside every one of our 10 to the 13 plus cells. But we have a whole range of agents that can damage DNA. Now, some of these are generated from the outside, radiotherapy, chemotherapies, for example, used in cancer treatment, damage DNA in most instances, ultraviolet light, we have the x-rays, a whole range of other things. But a lot of this DNA damage is actually taking place through endogenous metabolic processes, chemicals generated during normal metabolism. So it turns out that at rest, away from any external radiation or other chemical sources, every cell in the human body is sustaining 100,000 DNA lesions per day. And when you multiply that by the number of cells that exist in the human, this is a phenomenal amount of DNA damage that's taking place all the time, even at rest. Now, obviously, in order to maintain cellular functions and also maintain our DNA so that it can be passed on to future generations, there has to be ways of detecting this DNA damage, signaling its presence, and repairing it. So it turns out that in human cells, and in fact, every organism, there are a whole range of systems dedicated to different forms of DNA damage, detecting that damage and mediating its effective repair and stopping mutations occurring. And over the last 25 plus years, my lab and a range of other labs throughout the world have been characterizing these DNA repair and associated DNA damage response proteins and pathways. And collectively now, we know that there are several hundred proteins in a human cell, different proteins that play key roles in these DDR processes. Okay. So it turns out that this is a fascinating subject, understanding how cells detect signal the presence of and repair DNA damage. It's interesting from an academic perspective, but it's also very important when we consider human biology and disease biology. We know that acquired or inherited defects in these DDR and DNA repair pathway processes give rise to a whole range of phenotypes connected to disease. For example, defects in DNA damage response pathways confer hypersensitivity or to chemotherapies, but also radiation. Defects in these pathways can also give rise to developmental defects, immune deficiency, neurodegeneration, and in quite fascinating ways, contribute to premature aging. So damage to DNA is probably one of the things that's associated with aging, and defects in repairing DNA damage, of course, is going to accelerate those processes. These DNA repair mechanisms and defects in them will also impact on other things such as fertility, and perhaps most notably, cancer. Well, in fact, DNA damage response and cellular responses to DNA damage have massive relevance to cancer. First of all, we know that DNA damage can give rise to mutations if the damage is not repaired correctly. And we know that mutations are crucial for fueling carcinogenesis. We also know that DNA damage response and DNA repair defects, either acquired or inherited, predispose to cancer. And some of the key tumor suppressor proteins that we know about include things such as P53, BRCA1, BRCA2, ATM. Defects in these pathways, these proteins, give rise to cancer because they, in part, they allow more mutations to accrue. We also know that radiotherapy and most chemotherapies used in the clinic for cancer actually work by inflicting DNA damage. And the success of these treatments, which are used obviously very, very widely, is caused by cancer cells being killed by the DNA damage. But of course, we need to understand as well about the side effects to normal cells, because side effects of chemotherapies and radiotherapy, of course, are brought about in large part through those agents damaging the DNA of normal cells. It's also become clear in recent years that DNA damage response biomarkers have diagnostic and prognostic potential in cancer and also other disease areas. We know that the DNA damage responses in the cell interface with other cancer relevant processes, including cellular proliferation, telomere control, and a whole range of other things, metabolism, for example. And it's become clear over the last 20 years or so that these DNA damage responses actually provide some very attractive drug targets. Well, with this in mind, quite some years ago now, I had the idea of setting up a company I called QDOS. And the concept behind QDOS was to develop drugs to inhibit DNA repair. And the basis for this were certain biochemical assays that my lab and other labs had established, many DNA repair enzymes or enzymes, and therefore you could think about ways of developing drugs to inhibit their activities. So the idea was to use chemical screens to identify compounds and then through iterations to develop drugs that could be used to treat patients. Of course, the big issue to get this company off the ground was the first response of anybody, including venture capital groups, pharmaceutical companies, when I presented these ideas. Why on earth would you want to inhibit DNA repair when DNA repair is generally a very, very good thing? Defects in DNA repair cause disease. Why would you want to inhibit DNA repair? Well, it turned out that after a while of articulating things and doing some experiments, we realized that there were opportunities, particularly in cancer, where you would want to inhibit DNA repair. And a very important aspect of the QDOS business plan was this passage here with some associated data supporting the premise. Well, rather than getting you to read through those words, I just wanted to share with you basically the concept that we're trying to exploit and describe in those early days. So the prediction was that DNA repair defects may be an Achilles heel for many cancers. Now, why would that be the case? Well, as I mentioned to you a few moments ago, losing DNA repair pathways, either through inherited predisposition or during the progression of a cancer, is one of the hallmarks of cancers. Almost every full-blown cancer has lost one or other DNA repair or DDR factor. If we put that together with this concept here, synthetic lethality I described to you at the beginning, we could understand how this DNA repair pathway lost during tumorigenesis or fueling tumorigenesis could provide a therapeutic opportunity. So if we look on the right here, if we imagine a hypothetical situation where there are two DNA repair pathways or two DNA repair proteins encoded by genes A and B, which have this synthetic lethal relationship. And if we can imagine that one of those, in this case, gene B and the product of gene B becomes lost or mutated in the context of cancer. So if we have this scenario here, of course, the cancer cell would be very reliant on the remaining pathway, pathway A. So of course, we could think about knocking out the gene A, but one of the concepts behind QDOS was the idea of coming up with an inhibitor of the product of gene A. And the prediction based on this model here would be that this inhibitor of the product of gene A will be selectively toxic to the cancer cell, but not to the normal cell, which has this compensatory pathway, for example, generated through the product of gene B. Now, to cut a long story short, QDOS was able to develop an inhibitor of a DNA repair enzyme called poly-ADP ribose polymerase, or PARP. And this drug, called olaparib, with a trade name LynparzaTM, was launched in 2014 as a precision medicine for ovarian cancers with BRCA1 or BRCA2 mutations. The critical thing here is that BRCA1 and BRCA2 are actually genes that generate the proteins BRCA1 and BRCA2 that are connected to a key DNA repair pathway called homologous recombination. So it turns out that in patients with BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations, the cancer has lost the remaining function of that BRCA1 or BRCA2. And that renders the cancer cells deficient in homologous recombination, whereas the normal cells of the patient retain that function. And it turns out that PARP inhibitors, such as olaparib, are selectively toxic to the cancer cells of those patients, but not the normal cells, which retain at least one copy of the BRCA1 or BRCA2 gene. So it turns out that olaparib was the first approved DNA repair enzyme inhibitor drug prescribed now throughout the world. The world's first synthetic lethality medicine, if you want to call it that. It was the first cancer drug targeting inherited predisposition, although we now know that drugs such as PARP inhibitors can also be used in sporadic cancer settings. It was launched with a genetic diagnostic to detect the patients with the right type of mutations, so that obviously the success was likely to be higher. Since the original approval, olaparib has been approved for not just ovarian, but also breast, pancreatic and prostate cancers, with other cancers being looked at. And right now, over 35,000 patients have been treated with this agent. I should also point out that this compound, which has been co-developed by AstraZeneca and Merck, is just one now of many of a range of PARP inhibitors that are being developed by a range of companies throughout the world. So this is a very exciting time. And it's also very exciting that as PARP inhibitors are being used more widely, and as they're being used earlier in cancer treatment, the effect is becoming more pronounced. So if we look from left to right here, we're looking at the outcomes of three different clinical trials. And what we're looking at in each case, the red line is the patients that have been treated with the PARP inhibitor, in this case, olaparib, whereas the blue line are the placebo-treated individuals. And as you'll note, there are marked differences between the trajectories of those lines. And the key thing is that the difference, the benefit generated by the PARP inhibitor is becoming greater and greater throughout these trials. And so the impact on progression-free survival is increasing. The use of PARP inhibitors earlier in cancer treatment and earlier in cancer treatment is having greater benefits. So this is great, but it isn't really good enough. Even in these later trials and these later registrations where there's a big impact of the PARP inhibitor, some of the patients are not responding, although you would predict they would at the outset. In other cases, the patients respond but acquire resistance. And so a challenge for clinicians is to try and understand those resistance pathways and maybe head them off or even exploit them. And from an academic perspective, it's a fascinating area to try and understand how can it be that certain cancers do evolve resistance to PARP inhibitors and other agents. So this has been of interest for us and other labs throughout the world for a number of years now. How does drug resistance arise? And of course, there are a range of ways that that can be brought about. What we've been doing are carrying out genetic screens in the lab to try and understand those processes. And in a way, the way we're carrying out those genetic screens with CRISPR-Cas9 technology, for example, is being to use the alternative to the opposite side, if you like, to synthetic lethality, synthetic viability. So what we're looking for here are scenarios where you can kill a cancer cell, for example, with a drug in the presence of a mutation, such as in BRCA1. And we're trying to identify other genetic changes that will allow that cell to survive in the presence of the drug. So the general way that we carry out these CRISPR-Cas9 or other CRISPR screens is to start out, in most cases, with a lentivirus. This is a way of delivering into a cell population expression vectors that generate the CRISPR RNAs. These are transduced often a genome-wide library, but they can be focused libraries of DNA sequences that can be generated in massively parallel ways and cloned into these lentivirus vectors. Transduce those libraries into cells expressing, in this case, Cas9 nuclease. And then in different cells, different CRISPRs are going to be taking the Cas9 to different genes and generating a population of cells knocked out for each of, for example, of the 20,000 or so human genes. So from that population of knockouts of different genes, for example, you have an edited cell population that you can then select for sensitivity or resistance to a drug. And at the end of that selection process, one can carry out PCR reactions with associated DNA sequencing to look at the distribution of the different CRISPRs in that population at the end of the enrichment compared to the beginning. And by looking at the differential, you can then predict which CRISPRs and thereby which genes, when knocked out, will be conferring resistance or sensitivity to whatever condition that you've exposed the cells to. Of course, you'd have control non-treated populations that you've run in parallel. Now, it turns out the first example of such a screen we carried out a number of years ago was in the context of BRCA1 mutations. And through looking for ways that these BRCA1 mutated cells could become resistant to PARP inhibitors, we and several other labs throughout the world identified a new couple of DNA repair proteins, which we called shielding. Okay, so the outputs of these screens can be depicted in various ways, but one example is shown here. And that basically, through these screens, four genes, which when knocked out would confer resistance to PARP inhibitors in this BRCA1 setting, we identified certain known factors, such as a TP53, binding protein 1. But we also identified, actually, as a collective with the top hits, these two proteins, C20ORF196 and FAM35A, which had not been characterized before at that stage. As you can see, these genes came out as very strong hits with three different PARP inhibitors that we used in parallel. Now, to cut a long story short, through ensuing mechanistic studies and validation studies, we've been able to understand what shielding actually does. So these two proteins and a third protein called shield3 work together to promote a DNA repair pathway called non-homologous end joining. Non-homologous end joining is a way of piecing together two broken ends of a, for example, a chromosome. Now, it turns out that shielding promotes this pathway, but actually gets in the way of another DNA repair pathway, the pathway of homologous recombination, the pathway that BRCA1 and BRCA2 are involved in. Now, it turns out that in normal cells, cells can carry out a non-homologous end joining. They can also carry out homologous recombination, because we've learned that one of the key functions for BRCA1 is to antagonize the functions of shielding to allow, in the right context, for example, in the presence of PARP inhibitors, for homologous recombination to take place on these types of DNA breaks. So what happens, we've learned, and other researchers have learned studying this shielding complex, is in the absence of shield 1 or shield 2 or shield 3, you have defective in non-homologous end joining, which leads to defective aspects of telomere function, but also hypersensitivity to ionizing radiation. In the absence of BRCA1, the cell is no longer able to effectively counteract the activity of shielding on homologous recombination. And this is one of the reasons why BRCA1 defective cells are deficient in homologous recombination, because of the antagonistic impact of shielding that can no longer be overcome. But of course, in the absence of BRCA1, if you also lack shielding, the cell is able to carry out a homologous recombination because shielding doesn't get in the way anymore, even in the absence of BRCA1. So collectively, these data indicate that one of the key functions for BRCA1, a gene we've known about for many, many years, a protein that we've known about for many, many years, is to counteract the activities of shielding. So we believe that loss of these shielding components, either through genetic changes or epigenetic changes, could explain some of the resistance that's arising in cancer patients. But of course, the question is, would this really help the patients in the long run? Understanding resistance mechanism may be of interest, but is that going to help the patients? Well, I'm relatively optimistic that in the end, understanding the mechanisms of resistance may actually be very, very useful clinically. And that's because a resistance mechanism to one agent, such as a PARP inhibitor, what we're finding is often giving rise to another vulnerability, which could give rise to another therapeutic opportunity. So, for example, what we found is that shielding loss in BRCA1 deficient cells makes them more resistant to PARP inhibitors. But these double mutant cells are now more sensitive to other DNA damaging agents, including DNA cross-linking agents such as cisplatin. And in another scenario that we've been exploring, we can find that loss of certain factors, such as the non-homologous end joining factors, XRCC4, DNA ligase 4, provides resistance in ATM deficient cells to agents such as camptothecin, but also PARP inhibitors. But these double mutant cells lacking these factors such as XRCC4 are now more sensitive to ionizing radiation. So collectively, I think in the end, if we can understand resistance mechanisms that are operating in cells and ultimately in real clinical settings, we may be able to find ways to chase cancers into blind alleys. There's only certain ways that you can reroute things to repair DNA damage. And if we understand these reroutes, we might be able to find ways of exploiting them and closing them off. So using the synthetic viability, synthetic lethality principles, I think understanding how cells give rise, how cancer cells can become resistant to therapies, and understanding how those changes give rise to collateral vulnerabilities may allow us in the long run to exploit, head off, and take advantage of these pathways in clinical settings. So just to round off today, I just wanted to highlight to you my view that there are many other exciting opportunities for DNA repair and DDR research in the academic sphere, but also in commercial settings and medical settings. There are a range of companies throughout the world trying to develop and successfully developing small molecule drugs against other DNA repair enzymes that have been used in a range of ways, including in other synthetic lethality scenarios. And then just finally, I think that the kinds of processes, the approaches that we've been applying and others have been applying in cancer are increasingly becoming potential opportunities in a whole range of disease areas. In the end, biology, health and disease, it's all about balance and imbalance. Health is about physiological and cellular balances. Disease is about imbalance in those processes. And if we can understand, monitor, and alleviate pathological imbalances through understanding fundamental mechanisms, as I've described to you today, I think this could be a general approach relevant to essentially every human disease. So in this regard, over the last 10 years or so, I've been associated with setting up a couple of other companies, one of which, Mission Therapeutics, is targeting a set of enzymes called deubiquilating enzymes that regulate a process called ubiquitination. Deubiquilating enzymes are druggable targets, and by inhibiting them, this provides opportunities of regulating a whole range of intracellular processes, including controlling the levels of certain proteins that are connected to disease. Finally, and most recently, I've been involved with colleagues in establishing another biotech company based just down the road in Cambridge, Babram Cambridge, called Adrestia Therapeutics. And the broad approach that we're taking in Adrestia is to take cellular models of human genetic diseases, identify phenotypic imbalances in those settings, and then identify genetic as well as pharmacological opportunities to rebalance those pathological mechanisms, essentially through using the concept of synthetic viability, identifying targets connected to human genetic disease, and in the long term, we wish to develop therapeutic agents to target those factors and therefore rebalance disease. Very exciting times at Adrestia, very exciting times in DNA repair research, and all this is fueled, as I pointed out at the beginning, by these fantastic developments that have occurred over recent years that allow us to do some fantastic biology that we wouldn't have thought possible just a few years ago. I'll leave it there. And take questions. Thank you.